Thank you for joining us this afternoon for our contact event with Tim Peake on the ISS. I'd like to extend a warm welcome to the students, parents, partner schools, special guests, and members of the press, as well as the viewers on the ARISS web stream, which is relaying our event to the internet and the rest of the world. My name is Alfie Taylor, and I'm head boy at Brightstowe.
Hi, I'm Yasmin Kongsville, and I'm head girl. It is a pleasure and an honor to have the opportunity to share this incredible, exciting, and inspirational event with you this afternoon. We know that Tim's mission is a historic occasion, not just for the UK space industry, but for all our peoples here, who will remember and be inspired by this event for years to come. Without further ado, I would like to introduce Mr. Doherty, Principal of Oasis Academy Brightstowe.
Wow, and this is quite incredible. It's absolutely fantastic. I'd like to say a big warm welcome to everybody here to Oasis Academy Brightstowe today, where there's so many thanks to say to so many of you here, because this is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity that we're getting to speak to the first British ESA astronaut, Tim Peake. So thank you very much to all those people who have helped make this happen. Tim's mission is truly an historic event. 47 years ago now, we put a man on the moon, and 25 years ago, the first British astronaut, Helen Sharman, voyaged to the Mir space station. Such events as these really do inspire whole generations of people, young and old, to consider the heights we can reach when we strive for our goals, and to explore the world of science, technology, engineering, and mathematics in a whole new light. Here at Brightstowe, we gain academic success and outstanding results. But we know that without the strength of character and personal aspiration, these are meaningless. The event today and all the fantastic workshops that have been going on, the learning experiences and events which have led up to this, have provided our students with the chance to explore STEM subjects. But more than that, they have provided engaging opportunities for our students to collaborate with our primary, sixth form, and business partners, and to challenge our own aspirations and to inspire big dreams. This is not just one day. This is the spark that will fire hundreds of bright futures for our young people. I hope you have a great time this afternoon and welcome.
We have an introduction from Dr. David Parker, Chief Executive of the UK Space Agency.
Thank you. Hello, hello, Shirehampton. I was one of those people inspired by space 47 years ago when man landed on the moon. I was 7 years old. I got into space back then. And if you're excited about space back then, what do? You collected little picture cards that came in packets of tea, and you stuck them into an album. We've moved on a bit since then, and now we don't just have to dream about the space program that's happening somewhere out there, somewhere out in America or wherever else, Russia. It's happening right here, it's happening in Europe, it's happening in the UK, and we're bringing the space program here to you today. We are really delighted to be here. It's a pleasure to be in my home city, Bristol, to be in one of the 10 schools selected to be part of this amazing opportunity to talk to Tim on the space station. I hope you're going to enjoy it. You don't want to listen to me, you want to talk to Tim. Are you ready to talk to Tim? We're ready to go. Over to you, Kieran.
Right, hello everybody. My name is Kieran. My call sign is M0XTD, and you're going to hear an awful lot of letters and numbers being called out, but it's one of the requirements for a radio station, just like you listen to Radio 1. Every so often they'll say you're listening to Radio 1, so we're going to be using these as well. ARISS is a short name for the Amateur Radio on the International Space Station program, and that is something that five major space agencies around the world have grouped together. Actually, 20 years ago, the request was made to group together and to provide the amateur radio on the International Space Station as a program. And 15 years ago this year, we actually made our first contact. So we are coming up within a couple of months of our 1,000th contact in that time. So the International Space Station is party to NASA, ESA, JAXA, Roscosmos, and the Canadian space industry. And ARISS, as an organization, is supported by the National Amateur Radio Societies and also the AMSATs, that is the Amateur Satellite Corporations around the world. And these are people who have got a simple interest in communication, but through satellites. And not only that, but also designing, building, and launching their own satellites. Radio amateurs come from a huge walk of life, and what I want to do is just introduce you very briefly to everybody on my team today, and a rough outline of what they're going to be doing. So as I said, I'm Kieran, M0XTD, and I'm running the show. I have Carlos, G3VHF, on the radio, and we have Graham, G3VZV, on the backup systems, and we have Noel, G8GTZ, and Frank, this is going to be a challenge, M0AEU, yay, got it right. And they're working the video streaming for us. So we're taking all of this, streaming it out onto the internet, and hopefully lots more people will get to see it. Right, I've got a little game to get us warmed up first of all. How many of you have heard of the heads and tails game? Yeah, marvelous. Everybody else can follow. Everybody stand up. Okay, this is really easy. All you have to do is, if you think the height of the space station is 400 miles, put your hands on your head. If you think it's 400 kilometers, hands on your tail. Okay? Okay, if you've got your hands on your tail, you can sit down. Okay, really, really, really good little point there. Units are important. Okay? Right, everybody back up again. Right, we're all very familiar with mobile phones, tablets, radios, and the like. Who knows what flight mode is? If you know what flight mode is, hands on your head. If you don't, hands on your tails. Okay? If you've got your hands on your head, sit down. Okay, not too bad. And there's a very good reason for that. I would like everybody to please switch all mobile devices and tablets to flight mode. Okay? Doing that, you can still use your cameras, but the reason we do that is that we do not want that interference noise coming over the PA system that you sometimes hear, because that will simply distract from what we're doing. So tablets, devices, phones, whatever, to flight mode, please. Okay, and this one is for the students. Who's the biggest petrol head here? Sorry, I can't see. I've got a light right in my eyes, so I can't see. Excellent. What's the fastest speed of a car that you know of? 2. Oh, I love the point too. Okay, who knows the speed of light? Miles, I did it. It's easy. Yeah, okay. Okay, who knows the speed of the space station as it's orbiting the Earth? I know Libby does. Ah, oh, you stole my thunder. Yeah. 17,500 miles per hour, 28,000 kilometers per hour, or roughly 7-8 kilometers per second. So that's almost like going from here to, what, probably the other side of Almondsbury in 1 second. I think that beats your car any day. So the whole purpose of today is that we've got lots of different speeds. We've got the speed of light, which is the speed at which radio waves travel at, and we've got the speed of the space station. Now, if light could go around the Earth, anybody want to hazard a guess how many times it could go around the Earth in 1 second? Go for it. Oh, God. I haven't done that one. No, I have done that one before. Okay, yeah. And our challenge is basically to get something that's traveling at 17,500 miles per hour, linking up with something that's traveling at 186,000 miles an hour per second. And I've got a little example just to give you an indication of how tricky that is. So where are the guys with the ball and the torch? Yeah, come on, guys. Okay, so we've got Jen at the back, and what is going to happen is that hopefully we can dim the lights a second, but we're going to get the ball thrown from Pete. Yep. Oh, I'm sorry, I've really forgotten Adam. They're going to throw it, and Jen is at the back with a torch, and what she's going to try and do is keep the torch on the football as it's thrown. Okay? Go for it, guys. Did she do it? Okay, go back again. Okay, well done. Not many, but I haven't seen that done too many times, so well done, guys. Okay, so what we're doing here today is a massive experiment, and I want you to keep that in mind, okay? What's the one golden rule that your science teachers tell you about experiments? Anybody know? Anybody want to hazard a guess? Go on then.
Don't eat anything.
Oh yeah, that's applicable for here. Okay, experiments can go wrong. So one of the things is we try to prepare as much as possible, but there are things that can happen that can cause an experiment to go wrong. We hope it isn't going to go wrong, but we never know until we've actually carried out the actual experiment itself. So we're not going to know if we're going to make contact with Tim until Tim comes over the horizon and we can start to see him from a radio perspective. And that'll happen fairly shortly. Tim is where he's coming over the Caribbean at the moment, coming into the Atlantic and arcing up towards the UK. So we're about 10 minutes away from meeting with Tim. And hopefully we're going to do two things. We're going to hear Tim, and we'll maybe actually see Tim. One of the things we've done as part of this project with the UK Space Agency is to get an agreement to use one of the Goon Hilly dishes, which you may well know of down in Cornwall. And that is going to receive TV pictures from the space station. Now, these are pictures that have been, or a system that has been designed by radio amateurs, built and flown to the space station, and with some luck, we will pick them up. Now, the dish at Goon Hilly is 3.8 meters. How many of you have seen the Land Rover that's parked up by the railings itself? Yeah, lots. That's our attempt at it as well. And we've got a 1.2 meter dish, or at least it was until the other day. you can ask Noel what happened. And what we're going to do is we're going to see if we can do a very little a science experiment ourselves, because hopefully somewhere, yep, over there, you can see a couple of maps, a couple of dials in the bottom part of the diagram. On the left is the local Land Rover, so that's the one over there. And on the right is the one from Goon Hilly, which is currently saying nothing. Okay. Basically, if you can see those little graphs, they're all full of speckles at the minute. As we actually start to decode the television signal, those signals will start to form little pinpricks in the four quadrants of the graph. And if some of you are able to, have a look and see how long it takes Goon Hilly to do that versus how long it takes our Land Rover to do that. It doesn't mean to say it'll work, because, again, huge experiment. Where else can you do an experiment this big and using this many pieces of equipment, both on the ground and in orbit at the same time? So, as part of it being a big experiment, we also try to do the most we can to prevent things going wrong on our side. So here, we've got a huge amount of equipment that we've been doing, and you've probably seen some of the antennas up on the roof as well. Those antennas are rotating, so they will actually, hopefully shortly, start turning and pointing to the west, and then it will follow the space station in an arc as it goes over the top of the UK before disappearing out the other side of Europe on us. All of that's controlled here. You can see the little television screen so that we can have a look at it. As you can see, sometimes the ball experiment works, sometimes it doesn't, but we want to guarantee that it works, so we have a computer helping us to control the radio, control the antennas and make sure they're pointing in the right direction. The other thing we do is we use the computer to control something called Doppler. How many of you have heard of fire engines in a distance, or police cars in a distance, and as they come towards you, their siren changes in tone or frequency, gets louder as it comes towards you, and then it goes quiet as it goes away? You've seen that? We're going to have the same problem. Tim is moving, so the frequency that he's going to be communicating with us on is going to be changing. So we're actually using the computer to do all the calculations to give us the corrected frequency so that we can ensure that Tim hears us as best as he can. And that's what all this is about. And we just do as you do in an experiment. We test it, we double test it, and then we triple test it, and then we go and test it again. All to make sure we can get this experiment to work. But it is an experiment. So we are coming up on 4 minutes, okay. And what we're gonna do now is we're just gonna start to get ourselves into a position to get ready to do this. So if you don't mind, for just a few moments, I'm going to start double-checking things with Carlos one last time, and then we'll get going on the contact. Before we do that, the other thing that we have to do with Tim when we've answered all, or he's answered all of our questions, is that we want to give him a cheer so that he can hear it. So I'm going to ask you all to give me your best cheer that you can when I count down from 3 to 0, okay? So 3, 2, 1. Thought so. Let's try again. Clap, stamp your feet, whatever you want, but a really nice loud cheer. 3, 2, 1. He's fussy. Let's try it again, even louder. 3, 2, 1. Perfect. So towards the end of the contact, I'm going to invite everybody to show their appreciation to Tim and just go mad, and then hopefully we'll hear Tim coming back. What'll be important is that I'll try and give you a sign where I want you to go quiet, because if you don't go quiet, we're going to miss hopefully what Tim says on the way back. Okay? Right, so we'll be with you in a few moments as we're getting ready to talk to Tim. Okay, folks, so just one quick reminder about mobile phones and tablets, please. Can we make sure they're on flight mode? Feel free to take pictures. That's what this is all about. It's a memory that's going to live with you for a very, very long time. So we're getting ready. We are currently... not far off. So I'm going to start calling in a moment, so... We'll be there, just a moment.
Bravo 1, Oscar Alpha Bravo, GB1OAB, listening and standing by for a scheduled contact with the International Space Station. Over. GB1SS, GB1SS, this is GB1OAB, standing by and listening for a scheduled contact with the International Space Station. Over.
Hello, Golf Bravo 1, Oscar Alpha Bravo, this is Golf Bravo 1, Sierra Sierra, I read you loud and clear. How be, over.
Tim, a very warm welcome to you from the schools and teachers and parents at the Oasis Academy in Brightstowe in Bristol. Are you ready for your first question? Over.
I'm ready, and it's great to be speaking to you at the Oasis Academy in Bristol. Go ahead, over.
Hi, my name name is Emily. From my research, I have found out that you are taking part in 265 experiments. Which one is most important for us here on Earth? Over.
GB1SS, GB1SS, this is Golf Bravo 1, Oscar Alpha Bravo. Are you receiving? Over.
Hello, Golf Bravo 1, Oscar Alpha Bravo. This is Golf Bravo 1, Sierra Sierra. I read you loud and clear. I didn't hear the question at all. Over.
Hi, my name is Emily. From my research, I have found out that you are taking part in 265 experiments. Which one is most important for us here on Earth? Over.
Hi, Emily. That's a great question. It's difficult to choose just one, and I wouldn't like to show favoritism, but I think the most important ones for people back on Earth are the ones that are looking into medical research, research into vaccinations, into new drugs, and also into ways of recycling, clean energy. We recycle all of our water. We use solar panel up here. So I think energy and medicine are the two major topics which will help people on Earth. Over.
Hello, this is Luke. In your opinion, will unmanned missions ever be equal to manned ones? Over.
Hi, Luke. I think unmanned missions are extremely important. We've explored so much of our solar system, and we still have a lot of exploring to do. Unmanned missions are lower risk and lower cost, but ultimately, I think we'll always be more excited about human exploration. Over.
This is Francesca. In a microgravity environment, can dust, debris, and liquids cause a danger? And if so, how do you deal with it? Over.
Hi, Francesca. Yes, dust could get in your eyes and certainly cause eye damage, and also it inflames your airway. So we deal with it by ventilation here on board the space station. We have quite strong fans which keep all the air going towards filters, which filter out the dust for us. Over.
Hi, Tim. It's Kieran, M0XTD. We have you on Ham TV. Give us a wave. Here is your next question. Over.
Hi, this is Seema. My aim is to be the first female Afghan astronaut. What would be the one most important piece of advice that you have for me? Over.
Hi, Seema. I think that's a wonderful ambition to have. I think the best advice is to follow your dreams, to work hard, and just enjoy the journey. And I'm sure you'll get there. Good luck. Over.
Hi, this is Jack. Were you told what experiment you had to do, or did you get to choose? Over.
Hi, Jack. I love that question. As a first-time flyer, you pretty much do what you're told, but in all seriousness, if we don't like an experiment, we can say no to it, but most of us sign up to everything. Over.
Hi, my name's Ashley. How many day supplies do you have on board should a resupply mission not arrive as scheduled? Over.
Hi, Ashley. We try and keep 6 months' worth of supply on board. We had a few supply vehicles that didn't make it to the space station last year, so we're still topping up, but that's what we try for. Over.
Hi, my name's Lewis. How did you build the confidence to go into space? Over.
Hi, Lewis. Well, I never really lacked the confidence to go into space. I've always dreamed of getting here and wanted to get here. But if ever I'm concerned about anything, then I find that training through it and asking questions really helps with any apprehension. Over.
Hi, my name's Natalie. Why should we continue to fund expensive space missions when we have more pressing problems on Earth? Over.
Hi, Natalie. That's a great question. And there are many answers to that. Firstly, space is that expensive when you compare it to, for example, spending on other things around the world. We spend 40 times more on foreign aid, for example, than we do on space. And of course, up here, we are trying to solve problems down on Earth. We're doing cancer research. We are trying to solve the world's energy problems. We're looking at climate change. And all the money that's spent on space is actually spent down on Earth in terms of jobs for people. So really, it's all benefit for planet Earth. Over.
Hi, I'm Naz. If the world's leaders could see the Earth from your current perspective, do you think there would be a better consensus to sort out the problems of the world? Over.
Hi, Naz. I think there probably would be. You know, from up here, you realise just how fragile the Earth is, and that atmosphere is extremely thin. We really need to work together to look after the planet. Over.
Hi, I'm Karis. Did anything in your previous career or experiences prepare you for space? Over.
Hi, Karis. I feel like I've been preparing for space since I was a teenager. Everything I've done in all of my jobs has really helped me and prepared me for this mission. Over.
Hi, I'm Jacob. Why did you want to become an astronaut? Over.
Hi, Jacob. Well, for me, it was the pinnacle of a flying career. Being a test pilot, you push boundaries, you explore new things. And to go into space, to explore new frontiers, and to be at the cutting edge of technology for me was just the height of my professional career. Over.
Hi, my name is Emily. When you push on the wall of the space station behind you to move forward, does the space station move backwards due to the principle of conservation of momentum? Over.
Hi, Emily. That's a great question. And yes, it would do, but I weigh only 70 kilograms. The space station weighs 400 tons, so I won't make much of an impact. Over.
Hello, this is Luke. What do you think of NASA's planned One Way Mars mission, and would you go if given the opportunity? Over.
Hi, Luke. Well, NASA doesn't really have a one-way planned mission to Mars. They're the more commercial companies doing that. NASA wants to go there and return their astronauts to Earth, which I think is what we should be striving for, to actually explore Mars but always have an option to come home. Over.
This is Francesca again. Can you feel the International Space Station shake or wobble? Over.
Hi, Francesca. Great question. Not really, but what you can feel it do is do a reboost. And the other day, I floated about 5 seconds before the reboost and watched myself drift backwards through the space station as the space station was boosted forwards. Over.
Hi, this is Seymour again. Being in microgravity environment causes a decrease in muscle mass and bone density. Other than exercise, what measures are you taking to protect your health? Over.
Hi, Seema. Well, you mentioned exercise. The only other thing we can really do is well, so we try and look after our nutrition up here as well and try and prevent any of the negative effects of microgravity. Over.
Hi, this is Jack again. Considering that in space you are weightless and time has a different value, do you age at a different rate? Over.
Hi, Jack. I don't think we've got time to go into Einstein's equations, but the answer is yes, by fractions of a second, I'll be a little bit younger when I come home due to the fact we're travelling so fast. Over.
Hi, it's Karis again. Astronauts go through lengthy and intensive training for their journeys. Was there anything that you were not prepared for? Over.
Hi, Karis. Great question. Our training was so good, I think it prepared us for everything. But the Soyuz, the physical feelings and the noises of that Soyuz launch and coming up into Earth's orbit, that was remarkable, and no training could really prepare you for the sounds and the feelings of a rocket launch. Over.
Hi, it's Jacob again. How are your experiments helping to save Earth? Over.
Hi, Jacob. Well, experiments that we've done in space have helped with vaccinations for things like salmonella, and we're investigating MRSA. They've helped us to develop clean water recycling systems that can be used in third world countries. Actually, we're trying to solve lots of problems regarding aging, medicine, and the Earth's climate up here. Over.
GB1SS, this is Golf Bravo 1, Oscar Alpha Bravo. Tim, that was absolutely amazing. Everybody here wants to send their appreciation to you. GB1SS, this is Golf Bravo 1, Oscar Alpha Bravo. Tim, absolutely brilliant. Give us a wave before you... Oh, you're gone. Absolutely brilliant. You're doing a wonderful job and everyone here is really proud of it. This is GB1 Oscar Alpha Bravo handing back to GB1SS for a final. GB1 Oscar Alpha Bravo out.
I think that was absolutely amazing, and we got a wave from Tim as well, so another little first for us as well. I would like to say thank you guys, you did a wonderful job, you spoke really brilliantly. I hope you've all enjoyed speaking to Tim and it's something that you'll remember for the rest of your lives. Okay, so well done. Okay, you've heard the word amateur a lot. I've talked about amateur radio, amateur, amateur. I hope you've got a little bit of impression that hopefully what we did here today was quite professional, even though we've really enjoyed it. But life is about learning, and this is what schools like this do really, really well. Our amateur radio license has a little phrase right at the very beginning of it, and it says it's for self-learning in radio communication, or self-training in radio communications or wireless telegraphy. I know he's going to correct me. But the important bit is the self-learning. We're not necessarily radio people by trade or by profession, but we are people who've got an interest in lifelong learning. And that's what I want to sort of get across to you. If we can achieve this, and we're amateurs, have a think about what you could achieve if you were a professional in a STEM type career. The world is out there and there's an awful lot of it for you. So, in traditional amateur radio speak terminology, I'm going to say thank you very much and offer you my best wishes by saying this is Golf Bravo 1, Oscar Alpha Bravo, 7-3s, off and clear.
Amazing. But it doesn't stop there. We now have for you an expert panel from the space industry to talk about their sector and answer any questions you may have. So get your thinking caps on.
And now to recognize some of our own students who have been out of this world during our space events and who have been incredible that we are over the moon with them.
Stuart Souch. Stuart showed an outstanding independence on the ARISS Space Day. He was very organized and showed great responsibility to lead over 50 primary school pupils during the Train Like an Astronaut event. Stuart also displayed great leadership skills and engaged pupils around him to reach a positive goal.
Crystal Dominguez. Crystal showed outstanding independence on the ARISS Space Day. She took ownership on her individual station and even told a couple of pupils off. Crystal demonstrated a good growth mindset by stepping out of her comfort zone and pushing herself, showing real courage.
Georgia Venn and Poppy Golder, who both showed excellent organizational skills and producing a delicious meal in the Ready Steady Cook Challenge.
Alfie Walters. Alfie showed great skill and put a huge effort into the photography activity. He set up and took interesting photographs as well as challenging himself to edit the photographs to a fantastic standard.
Megan George, Jamie Atkinson, Tess Bell, and Holly James for teamwork, expert helper in music.
AJ Singh, demonstrating beautiful work and a growth mindset when he designed a creative and very adventurous textile design for the cosmic quilts, an alien design.
Let's give a round of applause for that. We are almost at the end of our show. However, none of today would have been possible without the support and technical wizardry of ARISS and the Radio Society of Great Britain. Here to tell you a bit more about their work to inspire you to make some of the magic of today with you is Youth Committee Chair of the RSGB, Mike Jones.
Still works, yeah. Very good afternoon, everyone. My name's Mike Jones, and I'm from the Radio Society of Great Britain. Now, we look after the 60,000-plus people who have radio licences in the UK, and my role specifically is to lead the Youth Committee. and our role is to forward people like you guys, young people in amateur radio. So I'm going to show you a video now on some of the many possibilities there are in the hobby and how you can get involved.
We live in an age of amazing technology. But for some people, just being a consumer of off-the-shelf gadgets isn't enough. If you're bored with this and looking for something more exciting, why not take a trip around the world at the speed of light?
Delta Kilo 8 Lima Golf, this is Mike X-Ray Zero Sierra Sierra Whiskey. Okay, thank you Frank for coming back to my QRZ call. My name is Adam, as in Alpha Delta Alpha Mike, Alpha Delta Alpha Mike, Adam is my name.
We all love to communicate. Amateur radio takes you beyond being a mere gadget user. It challenges you by putting you in charge of the technology.
The bit that always interested me in the amateur radio was always the construction. One of the big things I've been interested in constructing is using the Raspberry Pi in amateur radio, because it's a small single board computer. It has a lot of potential, a lot of opportunities.
So we're building a radio receiver.
Okay.
And so I'm just on the part which is the demodulator.
This is a hobby with hundreds of different ways to have techie fun. Using this simple ham radio transceiver and a good antenna, you can talk to other amateurs around the world, and you can do it from almost anywhere.
I'm at a portable station.
The radio signals you transmit travel around the world at the speed of light. No internet connection or mobile phone signals are needed. Just your own skills as a radio ham.
I'm 11 years old and I'm about to do the foundation license here in England, over.
I got into amateur radio really to get a greater understanding of technology. I spend so much time on my phone, on laptops, and really have no idea how any of it works. It was a really, really welcoming experience for me, a really great community, and really, really easy to actually do.
In disaster situations, when normal communications are out of action, amateur radio still gets the message through, which is why many hams belong to organisations that train their members to provide emergency radio links when needed.
I like the practicality of being able to send a message and know how to get something out to someone under your own steam, so kind of making it yourself. And I'm very interested in being able to do the electronics, being able to build things, being able to be self-reliant. In communication, I think that's really interesting.
It's great fun talking to other hams in unusual and sometimes exotic places around the world and beyond. The International Space Station carries ham radio gear on board, and there's always licensed amateurs among the crew to use it, such as Commander Doug Wheelock.
I've really enjoyed using the ham radio and talking to ham radio operators all over the world.
Radio amateurs around the world also build and launch their own satellites, and hams anywhere can use them for space communication experiments. And of course, to chat to each other.
Golf 1 X-ray India Echo.
Golf 1 X-ray India Echo, Golf Bravo 1 Yankee Oscar Tango America, afternoon, 5 and 9.
We're using SO50, which is an FM transponder satellite, which was going over from about west to north, around 70 degrees elevation.
When computers and radios come together, there's a whole bunch of new opportunities for hams to connect by radio, sending text, transmitting pictures or real-time video, even displaying data from an amateur radio satellite orbiting the Earth.
Mike 6 November Yankee Kilo.
Sigu, GB1 Utah.
I got started in amateur radio because I'm a girl guide leader and I wanted to take up a hobby that I could do with my brownies.
the interesting aspect of amateur radio is that you do learn how it works, and you get to communicate with loads of different people, find out about different areas of the world. You learn a bit more about the science of how it works, and you have a much more profound understanding of something, a technology that is going on all around you.
In amateur radio, sport and radio fit together well too.
I'll take another bearing in a minute because I don't trust that.
These guys are trying to locate hidden radio transmitters, racing against each other and the clock.
Amateur radio is a fantastic hobby for anybody who loves technology. I've only really been involved in the hobby for a really short amount of time, and I've been speaking to people all across the world. It's a really, really inviting community. One minute you're speaking to somebody about amateur radio and it leads on to so many other discussions about other different technologies you may not have even thought of. So if you do get a chance, come and join us.
So that video there showed you just some of the many possibilities there are in amateur radio. So as part of the youth scheme we have in the RSGB now, last year we did something called a de-expedition to the Brecon Beacons. Now, a de-expedition is basically an expedition with a D shoved in front of it, literally simple as that. So while we were in Wales, we went up some mountains, went up Wanfac, Penivan, and a few others to make contact with people in places like the Cayman Islands, New Zealand, Australia, and America, using very, very little power with very, very simple antennas at the top of a mountain. Also, we have something called the Youngsters on the Air program. Now, last year, four young people went over to Italy for a gathering of over 100 young radio amateurs, people that are all your age, to basically go and have a week of fun in the sun. Also, only on Wednesday, we went over to the BBC studios up in London to New Broadcasting House. Now, we went up there to see how radio professionals work. And as Libby said a while ago, it's really, really about following your dreams. The amount of career and career opportunities there are by being a radio amateur and having that technical mind are absolutely fantastic. There's tons of people up at the BBC that do radio things. They were doing it live here a while ago. There was radio used there to get it live on TV. So the radio industry is something that's really, really, really booming nowadays. And with the Wi-Fi everywhere and the wireless technology we use, being a radio amateur is one of the ways you can get right in the heart of technology and advance it. And then last but definitely not least, only the other week you guys here were building your very own radio receivers. One of the great things about being a radio amateur is being able to legally and have a license build your own equipment, then actually use it to speak to people around the air. No, around the world on the air. We do have a presence on social media, so if you want to find out more or see how you can get involved, you can see what we do on Twitter at the RSGB Youth, on Facebook, or visit our website and drop us an email if you're interested. And then, much like the space experts, are there any questions on how any of this worked today or amateur radio in general? Oh, we got a microphone. Yeah, we've got a microphone. Any questions? This is where the room falls really, really silent. No, everyone wants to get back to their lessons. Fantastic. I'll pass it to whoever's next. Thank you, guys.
One of the questions we wanted to put to Tim was, what has been the most beautiful thing you have seen in space? Here at Brightstowe, we strive for magnificence in everything we do. To close our ceremony, we have the beautiful voices of our school choir in a tribute to another famous spaceman, David Bowie.
Thank you.
Satellite Corporation around the world, Goonhilling Satellite Earth Station and their partners, Satellite Applications, Catapult and Kinetic. Kieran and the ARISS team.
Three.
Susan Buckle and team at the UK Space Team.
Three.
Heather Parsons and the team at the Radio Society of Great Britain.
John, Clive and the Sharhampton Radio Club.
The Royal Signals.
Jenna and Explorium.
Andrew, Claire and the TALIS team.
Steve and the team from the Uni of Bristol.
Ellie and Sally from STEM Ambassadors.
Dr. Helen Mason, OBE.
Michael Johnson and Nick Stewart.
All of whom have volunteered their time, expertise, and resources to make our activity such a huge success. We'd also like to thank our primary and sixth form partners who have joined us for our space-related projects. Even Primary, C. Mills, Stowe Bishop, Long Cross, Oasis Vancouver, Safety, Colston, Red Maid, and North Bristol.
Lots of our business partners have joined us today and support us right here in our employability program. Thank you.
Now to Brightstowe and our amazing staff, who teach us brilliantly every day and who have made us laugh with shiny spacesuits and inspired us with GoPro weather balloons. Thank you.
Lastly, but by no means least, thank you to our fellow students. It is you who make the school special. And it is to you that we say, shoot for the stars, achieve your dreams, and never give up.
Yeah.
At the end of this whole event, we wish you all a safe journey home. Take heart that it will be much easier than tips.
Well done.
Patient, there is only one door, but have a very safe journey home and thank you so much.